Good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first item of, for consideration is the evidence on the Local Services Franchise Traffic Commissioners Notices and Panels Scotland Regulations 2024. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure. That means it will become law unless it's annulled. We first considered this instrument on the 8th of October, and we noted some concerns raised about bus franchising panels, and we agreed to seek further evidence. Due to the limited time, we wrote to five organisations and individuals, including the Scottish Government, and I thank them all for writing back. Their responses are included in the papers for this panel. Now, Douglas Lumsden has lodged a motion to annul the instrument. Before we have the formal debate on the motion, we are going to have an evidence session with the Minister and his officials, which gives us an opportunity to ask questions or seek clarification based on the evidence that we've received. For the record, given the interest in this item and in our local bus services, provision of local bus services, I've already asked the Scottish Government to give evidence before Douglas Lumsden lodged his motion. I'd like to welcome Jim Fairley, the MSP Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, and also welcome Sharon Wood, the Bus Policy Manager for Transport Scotland, Kevin Gibson, who's a lawyer for the Scottish Government, and Bridget Bryden, who is the Bus Regulatory Policy Team Leader for Transport Scotland. That's a snappy title. Thank you very much for joining us today. Minister, I'm going to give you a few minutes to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Convener. Thank you for inviting me to discuss the Local Services Franchises, Traffic Commissioner Notices and Panels Scotland Regulations 2024. As we know, franchising is an important tool for local transport authorities to improve services in their area. However, it is also a significant intervention in the local bus market. The franchising provisions in the Transport Scotland Act 2019 set out a new franchising model which seeks to deliver greater scrutiny and transparency in the franchising process. A key aspect of this is the inclusion of a final approval stage external to the authority who will assess the proposals before the franchise can take effect. Now, this acts as a safeguard to ensure that local authority transport authorities' franchising proposals have been carefully considered. Rather than this decision being made by Scottish Ministers, the 2019 Act provides for an independent panel appointed by the Traffic Commissioner with the intention of depoliticising the final decision-making process. These measures were included in the Bill in introduction, remained throughout the Bill stages and were agreed by Parliament. Parliament also agreed at the time that detail as to the operation of the panels would be set out in regulations. These regulations set out that detail and are fundamental to the operating of the franchise process in Scotland, not least in providing certainty to local transport authorities and how their franchising proposals will be considered. They make provision about a range of administrative and procedural matters to provide clarity and legal certainty as to how panels should operate. This includes setting of the eligibility criteria for appointments to panels, which preclude the appointment of anybody employed by operators affected by franchising proposals, or who could otherwise not act impartially in deciding whether to improve a franchising framework. This is designed to secure the independence of the panel decision-making. The regulations in the Act provide guidance to the panels in what they must consider when assessing a local transport authority's franchising proposals and providing further clarity on what is and is not relevant to the panel's decision-making. We have engaged closely with key stakeholders, including local transport authorities and the Traffic Commissioner's Office, on the development of these regulations. Their involvement has been crucial in creating procedures that ensure the approval process is both transparent and impartial. There is a keen appetite from a range of parties and stakeholders, including MSPs, some who are sitting here today, for franchising to be available to local transport authorities. However, calling for amendments to legislation or failing to pass these regulations will result in Scotland falling further behind in delivering franchising to improve services for passengers. Any proposal to significantly amend the panel process as set out in the 2019 Act at this stage would require primary legislation. As committee members know, policy development of this sort can be significant and would not be completed before the end of this parliamentary term. As I've said, these regulations make important provision about how panels should operate, as envisaged by Parliament in passing the 2019 Act. Were the regulations to be annulled, this could result in local transport authorities deciding to delay any franchising proposals due to legislative uncertainty. And I'm happy to answer any questions that members may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I should, when I was welcoming people to the committee, have welcomed Graham Simpson for joining the committee today. And you'll get some questions at the end of this session. Thank you, Minister, for that opening statement. It's interesting, on this panel you've got somebody who sat through the 2019 Act in the REC Committee and looked at it in some detail. And I think an ex-minister, Cabinet Secretary for Transport, who was responsible for it. So there is some knowledge. The 2019 Act, when it came before the REC Committee, I don't think this particular section was highlighted as a problem. But it's being highlighted now because it would be the only system, it would be the system used in Scotland and no one else. Do you think that justifies it being used in Scotland and sticking to something that wasn't perhaps made aware to the Parliament when they voted on this legislation?
Well, as I wasn't even sitting in this Parliament in 2019, I can't answer for what the decision-making process was at that time, but I trust the parliamentary procedure. I trust the people who are looking at these regulations or these acts as they're going forward have done their due diligence, so we are where we are. And in terms of whether we should continue with it, we have a very stark choice. We either don't continue it or we do. If we do continue with it, then franchising will happen quicker. If we don't continue with it, we are back to the point where we will have to change primary legislation, which, as you know, Convener, is not the simplest thing to do without a great deal of time and energy going into it.
I think a lot of the 2019 Transport Act was taken up by amendments. I seem to remember sitting in the committee and having over 100 amendments on the workplace parking levy alone. So perhaps this moved slightly under the radar that it was a failed system. So my question then, how long do you think it would take the government, if they were minded to bring up primary legislation to change this very minor part of the 2019 Act, Section 38, I think, Minister?
Well, we wouldn't be minded to change this part. We would have to change the bill and we would go back into... We'd be into beyond 2026.
So why would you have to change the whole bill if it's just a part of it?
Because this is set in primary legislation. It's part of the Act. So therefore, we would have to go back to the beginning and start again.
Can you not change a section within an Act by primary legislation? Sorry, Bridget, looks like she wants to help me out. I may be confused.
It would be possible to do that, but we would have to look at the whole Scottish franchising model. This has been built in as a safeguard. We would have to look at whether an alternative safeguard was needed.
Okay, there's a whole lot of questions from other members of the committee, so I'm going to come to Mark first, followed by Douglas and then Monica. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Morning, Minister, panel. Morning. Can I ask you to explain why you think a franchising scheme approved by a panel is less likely to be subject to legal challenge than one approved by a transport authority? Because that seems to be a key argument for why the government at the time decided to go down this route.
It could still be challenged legally, but having gone through a panel, that panel will have looked at all of the requirements for a franchise to be established, the financial model, the business case for it, as well as consulting other local authorities. So it's about crossing every T, dotting every I, and making sure that all the processes that we can agree with the Traffic Commissioner are in place and have been fulfilled so that the case for a franchise is as robust as it possibly can be. Why it could still be legally challenged.
Yeah, but in terms of the risk, I mean, you understand that there's concern around this particular panel model. There's not good evidence that this kind of system has worked well across the UK. But if your key argument here is that by going down the panel route, it reduces the risk of legal challenge, what is the evidence for that you see?
The fact that it has been robustly scrutinised by an independent body who have no political input and are separate from the organisations and the authorisers who want to actually put the franchise in place.
But is there evidence for that, that panels are...
Well, clearly this is the first one that we've done, so we don't have evidence, and as I've said before, it could legally still be legally challenged, but this is a safeguard to ensure that everything that is being done has been scrutinised to the fullest extent, and therefore any cause for a legal challenge would be lessened.
Yeah.
In terms of the fact that everything that has been required to be done in order to provide the services that we're looking to be supplied have been scrutinised at every level.
Right. Okay. You said earlier on that, you know, we are where we are in terms of this legislation. 2019 was quite some time ago. There's been a lot of water flowing under the bridge in terms of progress on bus franchising around the UK. There's a lot more experience now. If you were to revisit this provision again, if you were to revisit this through a Transport Act, would you go down this route? Is this the best route to go down in terms of securing franchising, given
would
what
I
know
personally,
about Wales? And...
Would I personally? Well, I would not answer that question right now. I'll go back and have a much broader look at everything going right back to 2019, which I have to be absolutely honest, I haven't done. I haven't gone back and looked at the debates or the amendments or anything done in the 2019 Act. But what I would reiterate is that we are where we are today, and we either pass this this piece of legislation or we don't. And what happens after that, we'll just have to see where we go.
Okay. Can I just ask one final question? That's around the guidance that could come on the back of this SI. So you understand the concerns that coming through the petition to Parliament, and I'm sure you've read the evidence as well and experience from elsewhere across the UK. What's your answer to that in terms of giving the likes of SBT and others who've got a real stake and an interest in seeing this happen? What's your answer to them? How can you deliver that reassurance right now through guidance or interpretation of this? I'm trying to help you here to find what the solution is, because I want to see a solution here as well, and I want franchising to happen as quickly as possible. I know we're on the same page, Minister, but I'm struggling to see what the fix is. I'm frustrated for you because there's a motion to annul this that's coming up.
Yeah. So what we can do is we will have a memorandum of understanding and the guidance is under development. If I suspect that somebody is going to ask the question, can we go ahead with this? Can franchising go ahead today, whether we have this annulled or not? And yes, it could. But what would happen then is the Traffic Commissioner would still establish a panel, but there would be no conversation with officials or the Scottish Government as to what that panel looked like, what its makeup would be, or what the parameters within what that panel would do. So the guidance that is currently under development would be part of this piece of legislation, which would allow us to have a full input into what the Commissioner will do when they set up the panel. So my understanding in 2019 was to ensure that we had no political interference in something that is so big and so important, that it was done independently. So this process has to be done. You cut the cord or you don't. It's kind of that simple. But we can put in the memorandum of understanding, the guidance that is currently under development would be the parameters within which the Traffic Commissioner would work to. If this is annulled today and we continue with the franchising, the Traffic Commissioner will make those decisions and we would have no input to that whatsoever.
Okay,
thanks very much, Mark. Douglas, you've got some questions.
Yeah, thanks, Gamina. I just want to pick up on that last point, first of all. So Minister, it seems to be what you're saying. If this is annulled today, the panels would still continue anyway.
It's in primary legislation.
So that would continue, and so the difference would be... So if this was annulled today, what would the government's response be, and what would they do? What would their next step be?
If it's annulled, Mr. Lumsden, I can assure you that myself and the rest of my day will be scrapped, so let's put it that way. And we'll go away and we'll have a very long, detailed conversation about what happens next. If it's annulled, what could happen is that the panels will still be implemented, and they will then be decided entirely by the Traffic Commissioner without any input from us at all. So that would be the net result. So we would then have to consider, is that a road that we are prepared to go down, or do we have to stop this in its entirety? That's why I'm saying we would be going back to square one.
But you say that could happen. Is that, would it happen, or would there be changes? I'm confused slightly, Minister, because obviously we've got a system that was tried in England, hasn't worked, they've scrapped it. Wales are doing something completely different. So I'm confused to why we as a committee and we as a parliament would actually approve what we see as a failed process.
Well, the process that you're talking about down south, the Nexus process, is different to what this one is. That was looking at the financial aspects of it. What we're looking at here is what the entire effect of a franchising would be. And I'll give you the example of my own area. I know that there are cross-border issues in bus transport, bus provision in my constituency. So, and I'm giving this as a pure random example of a possibility. If we decided in my area that we're going to go down a franchise route, we would then be required to talk to all the other areas in our locality, so that there was a kind of a joined up thinking. The process that you're talking about down south failed on financial levels. It was only that the business case that wasn't robust enough, which is my understanding. It wasn't robust enough for that to then be rejected. I think one of the beauties of what we're putting in here is that anyone who wants to go down the franchising route, and it will be entirely their choice to do so, they will have to be absolutely clear in their mind. We have put forward the strongest business case. We have consulted everyone who has got a stake and a vested interest in what this franchise looks like. We have spoken to our neighbours. There's people like, if you plant a hedge and it goes into your neighbour, it's a similar kind of thing that they have spoken to their neighbours, and it is about, we have taken the biggest possible picture that we can and said, yeah, this is something that we want to do, and this is the process we're going to go down.
But after speaking to your neighbours, you would think you would learn some lessons. You know, from your evidence point six, it seems that the government have no plans to revisit the Act at this time. So I guess you're not really going to be changing anything in that regard.
Well, we could revisit it. If that's what people want us to do, we'll revisit it. But we'll forget about franchising up until now in 2026, because we'll go back to stage one.
Is there any franchising going to be taking place between now and 2026?
Well, we're in the process of working towards getting stuff done now. We're a long way down the road. Now, why it has taken to get us to this point from 2019, again, I wasn't in the Parliament. I don't know why it's taken us to get to this stage, why it has taken so long, but we are where we are. And there is work ongoing right now. There are conversations being had to allow the memorandums of understanding to be established so that we know what that guidance looks like. So if we have this regulation passed today, we will proceed at the pace to get this done as quickly as we can. And I'm going to ask Sharon or Bridget, what would be the timescale for us having progress? If we get this through today, what would be the timescale at the next stage? Where would we be going from here?
So after this regulation, there was one more regulation that we required to bring forward on franchising. We had hoped to introduce it before Christmas. Realistically, it will be after Christmas now. And that is about the process of transitioning into and out of a franchise. There's also, as the Minister mentioned, guidance that's being developed to support local authorities. That is in draft at the moment. We've been engaging with local transport authorities on that, and we'll be looking at publishing that in the new year as well. And at that point, all the legislative process will have been completed. So any local authority starting franchising will know exactly what the expectations are as they're going through the system.
But I guess there's a criticism that the panel could potentially delay franchising. Is that, do you not accept that at all?
No, I think the panel will have a requirement to make the decision within a six-month period. But it would be up to whoever it is that's presenting the franchising proposal to have made sure that they've done all the work that they need to do in order for it to be progressed.
Okay.
From my own point of view, I think this is it's a real belts and braces. You know, nothing. If you're going to cut corners on this, you're going to get stopped. So therefore, why start in the first place? And it's just that certainty that there is someone else taking another look at this and saying, okay, you didn't do this bit or you didn't do that bit, so therefore do it right in the first place.
Which I could completely agree with, but it almost seems like we've we should be learning lessons from England and Wales, who have actually looked at this and tried to do it in England. It hasn't worked, but we are still carrying on with it.
But it was based on the financial model alone. It didn't take the whole picture. And that's the fundamental difference. That was rejected on the basis of a financial model. So the financial model is clearly a really important part of it. So we want to make sure that the business case has been done to its fullest extent, but it will include everything else as well. So we're not really comparing apples with apples here. We're comparing two different things.
Would our panels not be looking at the financials as well?
Of course they would. They'd be looking at everything. That's the point I'm making.
Sorry, but I've given you quite a lot of time on that, and there are other committee members who'd like to come in. I will bring you back in afterwards, but I'd like to widen it rather than just the two of you, if I may, at this stage. So, Monica, I'll bring you in, and then we'll see who's next. Sorry.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your officials. I think we all want to get this right, so I think that's not in doubt today. I think Mark Ruskell is correct. We're on the same page. I think we want to get this right. But just to follow on from Douglas Lumsden's questions, because the committee has asked a number of experts to give his views, so we're grateful for the responses we did receive. And I think it's important that we try and learn from the practice elsewhere. And you can correct me if I'm getting any of this wrong, but what we've heard from one of the witnesses or experts, Jonathan Bray, you know, a transport expert who advises the Welsh Government, in his submission to the committee, he says that the Scotland proposal proposes powers that go beyond the English Quality Contract Scheme board. That board was only required to make a recommendation, with the Transport Authority making the final decision on whether to proceed. However, the proposed panel and the draft legislation is given the duty to make the approval for a franchising scheme. So he goes on to say, this will put great weight on the decision of the panel and may leave the panel at risk of judicial review from incumbent monopoly bus operators, again risking the panel leaning towards the safer option of rejection. So I'd be interested to hear, Minister, what's your response to that? And if we're hearing expert voices elsewhere saying don't follow this discredited route, would you not agree that that's a good time to pause and really reflect? Because we want to get this right, don't we?
Yeah, absolutely, we want to get it right. But I'll go back to the point that I made. If we stop this and we don't do this, then we're back to square one. Potentially, we are back to square one. In terms of the evidence that you've heard from Mr. Brayford, the proposals that were rejected there, or they had recommendation as opposed to the final decision. You could turn that around the other way. If a transport authority knows that the final decision could be taken out of their hands, I go back to the point I was making to Mr. Lumsden, they're going to make damn sure they got it right in the first place. So therefore they're going to do all the work, the due diligence that they need to do in order to make sure that when they present that to the panel, they have done absolutely everything within their power to do so.
So I know time is, you know, we don't have all the time in the world today, but if we just look at the submissions that we've heard from Get Glasgow Moving and other organisations that have a lot of expertise, you know, there's a strong view coming across that this panel approach is not the right one and wouldn't be the right approach for Scotland to take. I hear the point you've made about if we don't approve the SSI and we can't, you know, give guidance to the Traffic Commissioner, they'll go ahead and appoint a panel anyway. But surely today we've got an opportunity as Parliament and Government together to say, well, look, we're going to have to take a different approach because we've reflected, we've looked at evidence, we've looked at practice elsewhere. Because the concern that I have is that whether you give the Traffic Commissioner lots of guidance or not, the Traffic Commissioner, you know, are they the right individual to basically appoint this panel? And without getting into a big constitutional discussion, from looking at the submissions, there is a point that's been made that, you know, this in a way undermines devolution because the Scottish Government is giving the final decision to the Traffic Commissioner, who is appointed by the UK government. So it just feels like we've got an opportunity to today. I know you didn't go back to square one, but maybe that's not a bad thing to use the time to get this right. So is that not something that you would recognise as maybe an attractive opportunity for you, Minister?
Okay, I could turn that round and say, if it's not the Traffic Commissioner, then who? So who would be the decision maker? Do you want that to come back to ministers? Therefore, we are then talking about being back in the political sphere. So that decision was made in 2019 that it would be taken out of the politicians' hands. So therefore, that's where we are. I'm sorry, what was the second part of your question, Monica?
You're comfortable that it would be the Traffic Commissioner?
I'm comfortable from the point of view that it will be the Traffic Commissioner on the basis that we will be allowed to create the memorandum of understanding, we'll be able to create the guidance. I remember the second part of your question now. Yes, but the Secretary of State appoints the Traffic Commissioner based on the fact that there are devolved and reserved matters within traffic legislation here in Scotland. Now, I voted to come out of the UK in 2014. This is a result of staying in the UK in 2024, is the fact that we still have these tie-ups with another parliament. So therefore, we live within the bounds of what it is that we are, that we voted to do in 2014. So this isn't about taking powers away from the Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament. This is about the reality of the position that we're in, that there are reserved and devolved matters that the Traffic Commissioner looks at. Therefore, it is through the UK Government's right to say that it will be the Traffic Commissioner will be appointed by the Secretary of State for Scotland. One of my officials sits on that panel that will go through the process of actually employing someone, but ultimately it is a UK Government decision because we voted to stay in the UK in 2014.
Okay, I don't want us to get too distracted about the issue at hand today, because as a parliament, you know, we've got decisions to make, and we want to get the best possible system for franchising, because that's what we want to see happening.
Yeah.
So really this comes down to, you know, this question about time and about delay, because, you know, when I saw the motion to annul, my concern was, although sympathetic to the principle of it and what it's trying to achieve, I was worried that it could cause delay and get in the way of franchising. Mm-hmm. But you know, there's not a franchising proposal sitting on the table right now. So I'm interested to understand what is the government's understanding of when you would expect to see the first proposal for franchising to reach approval stage? Because I'm trying to understand how much time we have to play with.
Well, there is a consultation ongoing at the moment with... my apologies. Let me correct the record. They will be consulting shortly on whether they're going to go for the franchising model or not.
And just to be clear, who is that? Sorry, who's consulting?
What does that start? Strathclyde Partnership Transport.
SPT.
Yeah, SPT, sorry.
Okay, so you expect a consultation, and then how long does the consultation period last?
How long does their consultation period last? Yes, I'll let Bridget answer.
Do we know the answer yet?
So SPT are currently working on the regional bus strategy.
Okay.
They've expressed a preference to franchise in their area, but they have not yet committed to it. I think they've said that they will make a final decision in the spring.
Spring 2025?
2025. And I'm sorry for not briefing the Minister enough on this.
Okay.
I'm not sure. I think they have a further consultation that's required on that.
Right, so it sounds like there's a bit of time to play with then. Nothing's happening quickly. So if we annul the motion today, we're not really getting in the way of this protest with SPT that's not started yet. I just wanted to try and get that on the record.
Right, okay. Yes, there is.
Okay, so there's time in hand. So realistically then, if the consultation gets underway spring of next year, when's the earliest that could reach the approval stage?
So I can't speak for SPT. I can't speak for the level of work that they've already done to date. They haven't yet started the official process that's required in the Act. I don't know whether they would be willing to do that without the legal certainty of all the requirements that they would have to meet. If they are, I think they said it would take them 5 years to go through the full process of getting a franchise to having the first buses on the ground.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I'll just One last question, because I know conveners came to let others in. So just trying to understand, because I know that you'd raised a question about possible delay if we, you know, vote to annul today. So consultation sometime next year, final approval stage, would that, do you expect that would be in 2025 or could that be in 2026?
If, I mean, again, it depends on what the outcomes of their consultation are. If they decide that they make a final decision to go ahead with franchising, we would expect to hear something next year. They will then have to go through all of the processes set out in the Act, which includes, because at the moment they are consulting on their regional bus strategy. They've not, you know, they've not developed their franchising proposals. They've not consulted on their proposals. Okay. They've not gone through an order.
So it's still a very early stage. That's helpful. Thank you.
Just before I come to the deputy convener, just to clarify a simple question, is that this is passed, the next legislation is passed. When is the first year that we could expect to see buses moving into the new way that you're suggesting they could happen?
So based on the legislation alone, if we assume that a local authority has already done all the work in the background... But
No, that's an assumption that you cannot make.
Yeah.
So we're starting from where we are at the moment.
Let's assume they've got all of the research they need to back up their business case and they're just waiting for the legislation to be in place before they start the formal processes in the Act. It would maybe take, by the time you've gone through all your consultations, you've drawn up your full document, it would take a couple of years before you get to the point of approaching the panel.
Before approaching the panel?
Mm-hmm. And then it's a six-month period for the panel decision.
So we're talking about a minimum of 26, possibly 27, if there isn't a fair wind and everything hasn't been done. So I just want to get this into my brain that I understand it. So I'm going to come to the deputy convener, Michael.
Thanks, convener. Just in looking at the evidence that we've received as a committee in this, which has been very limited, so it's one party and two organisations that have provided evidence in the matter, and that's because the committee's had little time to pursue the issue. And the evidence that we received from, was from Get Glasgow Moving. In the latter part of their evidence, they refer to SPT's own timeline for their SRBS process, which is part of looking at the franchising model. They set out that its franchising, I'll quote here, its franchising proposal will not be ready for full independent financial audit, and then in brackets, to be followed by a statutory public consultation until the end of 2025. And then they go on to say that means that will not be ready for final approval until later in 2026. And they then explain that gives a window of at least a year for the necessary legislative changes to be made. Is that timeline for them potentially seeking to, if they had to take it to a panel, does that sound right from the evidence that we've received?
I think that's been taken from SPT provided. They published a number of documents last year,
yeah.
And I think that estimate was in one of those documents.
I believe it is. I think it was in 2023 they published documents, from the check that I've made,
yeah.
As well. So that's their timeline. Mm-hmm. That would mean that the panel would have to be, or no panel would have to be, a decision around no panel or a panel would have to be in place by the end of 2026 on the basis of this timeline and this evidence. Is that correct?
Yeah, SPT are the first authority in Scotland to come out with any timeline for developing franchising, and that's the timeline that they've come out with.
Okay.
So we're not aware that anyone would want to come in ahead of them.
Okay. Because the reason I'm questioning that is because the Get Glasgow Moving then go on to say if the panel issue is not going to be resolved, I think I'm paraphrasing here in fairness to them, and they may want to challenge us, but if the panel can't be removed within that time frame, then they would see that they believe that the SSI should be passed only as an interim measure with a view to looking at doing something in the future that might be more appropriate as well. So what I'm trying to understand here is that timeline that they've set out, is it likely that there's going to be primary legislation brought forward between now and the end or later in 2026 to remove the requirement for a panel to consider any franchising proposal?
So we have done no preparations for that at the moment. I'm not aware of any legislative vehicles that would be suitable.
So your answer to that question then is no?
Realistically, it would be no.
Okay. So that would mean then, if their timeline is that they would be looking to do is take something forward later in 2026, if this is annulled, we'd be in a situation that the Minister set out where the Traffic Commissioner would establish a panel, but we would have no control over how that panel operates because of the existing arrangements in primary legislation. Is that correct? So, from what Get Glasgow Moving are saying, it would be better to take, even if you oppose the idea of the panel, given the timelines that SPT have set out, it would be better to take this forward as an interim arrangement in order to also allow them to make progress in this matter, but with a view to the government considering whether in the future there might be a more appropriate mechanism that could be used beyond the panelling system we have in legislation. Is that something which the government would consider doing, given some of the concerns that have been raised around the issue of panel, the panel?
I would need to consider that.
I'm conscious it's not necessarily entirely within your portfolio responsibilities.
Well, yeah.
But I'm, like any good government, you would always want to learn the lessons from experience and to build on that.
Yep.
And I've got no doubt the government would want to do that if it felt there was a more appropriate mechanism at some point in the future.
Yes.
But it wouldn't get in the way of... But that legislative change wouldn't happen before the end of 2026.
It would allow the process to continue just now to allow anyone who's looking at franchising to work on the basis that we are where we are and we are going in the direction we're going. But I am very aware of the concerns that have been raised by members here and out with. I've read the evidence, so I'm very aware of that. But I can't give any guarantees because the Cabinet Secretary would ultimately make the decision. But all I can say to you is that I am now acutely aware of some of the concerns that have been raised.
And of course you can't bind any other government post 2026 anyway. So, but it would, and I'm conscious that even after an election, legislation tends to get pushed back with committees, etc., and priorities being set. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Bob, you wanted to come in with some questions. Then I've got people who want to come back in, so I'll go to Douglas and then Monica, because I cut Douglas off, and then I'll come to Monica. So, Bob.
Very helpful. I want to ask a few questions about the guidance that will be implemented now. Will that guidance, I suppose, learn the lessons of the Nexus experience in 2015, which I understand it was? It will be cognisant that the UK Government changed its position in 2017 with the Bus Services Act. But I would also, I suppose, note that the Act that we're fully implementing today was 2019. So I suspect in 2019, when the primary legislation was passed, convener, everything we heard about today about we need to learn a lesson of what happened elsewhere, that was already known in 2019, convener, when we passed the primary legislation. And I would note that the Welsh experience is still fluid. It appears to be a national franchising system and is very different completely from what would be happening in Scotland. So the guidance that will be developed, will that take into account the experiences in England and Wales to make sure it's balanced, it's proportionate and it's fair to SPT and others that there will be a reasonable expectation that a strong and robust case will be approved by an independent panel? And if the Minister wants to...
Well, I'm going to ask Bridget to answer that because she's in the process of working through the regulations at the moment.
So we have been engaging with the Welsh Government and with the UK Government and also some of the mayoral authorities in England that are developing franchises or have franchises in place to learn from their experience, and that is informing the work that's going into the guidance document.
Okay, so is that a very concise way of saying that the Scottish Government will take into account the experiences that have happened elsewhere where people have raised issues with independent panels not necessarily being as, I don't want to use the word competent, but they were, if you're dissatisfied with an outcome, then you don't like the panel, I suppose, is the narrative around some of this. But is the Scottish Government confident that any lessons that need to be learned will be learned in the development of this guidance?
So the independent panel model was only tried once in England. Okay. So we're looking at
drawing experience not wider than that, than just the panel model. I would say the Scottish model, when it went through Parliament, has different approaches to what to the franchise model that operated in England at the time that that panel sat. So one of the key things the Minister has mentioned is that there is an audit of the financial situation, the business case, which takes place before you even get to your consultation. So some of these issues should be addressed far earlier in the process than what happened with the Nexus case when it was considered.
Okay, now I'm minded that SPT has been mentioned a few times, convener. They've not proactively contacted our committee in relation to this statute. I'm sure they're very, very well aware that it's happening, but they've not proactively contacted this committee. Can I ask you, Minister, whether or not they've proactively contacted yourself or the government in relation to the statute instrument, or if they will be key partners in consulting in relation to any guidance that may flow from the statute instrument?
So we have a working group of local authorities that have been feeding into the work on all of the legislation coming out of the Transport Act, and SPT sit on that group. We also engage with them separately on the individual concerns. They have engaged with us. I'm trying to think if they've written to us on panels. I don't think they've written to us on panels. But they speak to us regularly, and they have written to us on various points.
So if there was a fundamental issue at various points to aside, because the SPT and others coming up would want any statute instrument to reflect what they think is the best design and structure of it, similar with guidance, you're not aware of any overarching underlying issue that SPT have in relation to this, and can you just confirm they will be consulted as a matter of course in the drafting up of guidance?
So they've not reached out to us in relation to these regulations. Like I say, they were consulted when we were developing the panel model. We will definitely be consulting them on the guidance. Like I say, they are sitting on the working group. They've already made valuable contributions to the draft guidance.
I think all roads lead back to the guidance, convener. Can I check that if the pathway to franchising does not include the passing of this statutory instrument, then there will be no guidance for any panel to look at, and they'll be creating their own guidance, if you like, deciding themselves what they think the priorities are in relation to that. In other words, decisions can still be made by a panel, but it's less likely they'll make those decisions based on guidance which would be in the public interest. Would that be your understanding, Minister?
The Traffic Commissioner would have the authority to then decide all the parameters for the panel. The panel will still be established if we can continue on the same route.
Okay. Get Glasgow moving. I've got a live petition, not with this committee as yet. I suspect it may end up at our committee. But they ask, and can I thank them for their briefing ahead of today's meeting and for dialogue. But they ask for two things that appear contradictory. They want to fully enact the franchising provisions within the 2019 Act, which this seeks to do today as part of that. But it also wants a speedier, more streamlined, easier system to secure franchising. So, I'm not speaking for Get Glasgow Moving. They'll be watching this very carefully. They'll speak for themselves. But I suppose something that Mr. Matheson said: if we complete the powers of the 2019 Act, will the Scottish Government continue to monitor what's happening elsewhere, learn the lessons from what's happening elsewhere, and, if required, change course, reflect and change course? In other words, this will not be a myopic Scottish Government that will pass this and say job done. They'll continue to review what is actually happening elsewhere.
The asks of Get Glasgow Moving, I've heard for the committee's understand, are a very quick debate and discussion with Ellie outside before we came in here, and a lot of these points were raised. She makes a very strong argument. She's very good at what she does. But what she's asking for is that streamlining. But we're in the position where we are. We want to get this done. We want franchising to work. This is part of the legislation that is currently in place. If we don't pass this SSI, we will still have a panel. So the government would then have to decide how we take it forward from here. But in terms of our scrutiny of what's happening going forward, absolutely, we will be keeping a very close eye on how this develops, what the guidance is going to look like, and how that's all going to be implemented.
Okay, final question, Minister. I should, I suppose, point out that Get Glasgow Movement want to point out, the third point of the petition is cash, finance and money to make all of this work, because point one, point two are moot point if there's no cash in the system to do this. But if a future government did decide to unpick the provisions of the 2019 Act, I think we've heard already, it would be a full review of the franchising system again. That could take quite some time. Mr Lumsden, of course, during the debate will tell of his motivations for annulling this, and that's for Mr Lumsden to speak for himself. But there will be politicians that just don't agree with franchising and will use any tool in the toolbox to wreck that. Would it be a concern of yourselves, Minister, that without anything to replace this pathway to franchising, we have a risk that what replaces this in a future parliament may actually not be as robust as we currently have?
There may well be a risk, but my focus is right now where we are and how we take this to the next stage to make sure that franchising actually gets the opportunity to go ahead.
Okay, thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Bob. Douglas, thanks, and then Monica.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks for allowing me back in. Just wanted to pick up on a point, Minister. You say that the panels will still be created if this SSI wasn't approved today. But in terms of timescales for a panel created, it sounds like in terms of SBT are the furthest on in terms of the franchising. But even that is still many years away. So surely that gives you time to look at the legislation again, look at the franchising models again, and make sure that the panels are actually in place. Is that not correct?
It is, but it goes back to the point that Mr Matheson made. We are in the position where we have a timescale to get things done. I'd much rather we get this SSI passed just now, allow us to progress the work on franchising, and make sure that we continue the progress that we've already made.
But it doesn't really change the timescales, because what we've heard is that, you know, in terms of SBT, we're the furthest on. That's still, they're still continuing their work, and that's still a long way off. So surely it would be better to get this legislation, I would say, corrected and have it done correctly, as opposed to push on regardless. And even though I missed this opportunity to get the legislation correct.
When you're talking about a correction, what does that correction mean? It means us going back to the primary legislation. So I only see that creating a much longer delay and us going into the next session of Parliament.
But you said a question.
Okay.
That's two at the
count. I'll leave it there.
We are going to continue this into the next agenda item, and I'm sure you'll have a chance to allude to the questions if you get a chance to speak in that debate, which will be up to you. So, Monica.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you said that the decision in terms of what would happen next is ultimately one for the Transport Secretary. Ahead of today's meeting, have you discussed it with the Transport Secretary, or do you know the view of the Transport Secretary on this matter?
No. I envisage that what will happen today is, and I very much hope that what will happen today is that we will pass this SSI and allow us to continue moving forward the franchise. If that's not the case, then I will have to go away and we'll have to have some discussions.
So just to be clear then, in preparing for today's committee session, the government hasn't thought through the scenario that the SSI could be, you know, annulled today and you don't have a plan B in front of the committee, because... Yeah. I think we're looking to get as much certainty as possible about what government would do next.
I did not speak to the Cabinet Secretary when I learned that the motion to annul was being brought forward. I very much looked at, OK, what are the concerns? Why is this becoming an issue? I fully take on board the issues that are there, but I go back to the primary point that I made. If we don't pass this SSI, then it sets us back considerably.
OK, so just to be clear then, so in preparation for this morning's committee session, the views have not been sought from the Cabinet Secretary.
No.
You, Minister, and your officials haven't reached out to SPT or any other regional transport partnership to get their views.
No, that's not the case. SPT are very much part of the ongoing process that the officials
about this
are
SSI.
Working. Not specifically
that's
the SSI.
That's what I'm talking about, the SSI. That's the matter in front of us right now.
They're aware that this SSI is ongoing. So if they had a concern, my expectation would be that they would reach out and make their issues known. So it's not a case of the due diligence. What I think you're alluding to is that due diligence hasn't been done by the government. I don't think that that is the case. What I would suggest is that we learned late on Friday that there was a motion to annul. So we're now sitting on Tuesday morning. And I spent my time speaking with officials and saying, OK, where are the issues? What are the problems? How do we get round them? What will be the implications? And let's assume that we get this SSI done, we can continue. If not, then we'll have to go away and have another consideration with that. I'm not going to sit and do that over the weekend.
Yeah.
I'm going to make sure that we've done a proper consideration.
Yeah. So I wasn't trying to trick you about due diligence. What I'm trying to establish, because it's the what next part that interests me as someone who has to vote on this today. I was hoping to hear a bit more certainty about the government's position. Because the government, you know, understands that the committee might not vote the way you want to vote today, but we want to know about what happens next. So just so that we're clear, you've not discussed it with the Cabinet Secretary. It hasn't been discussed with key partners, including SPT. So we as a committee would have to have faith that you're going to take it away and talk to people, but we just don't know what that conversation would look like. So that's all, convener. I think just leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you. Graham, I think we now come to you for your questions.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. It's been a very full and interesting discussion so far. I think, Minister, the key thing for me, and it's been raised already, is basically what would happen if this regulation is annulled today, and from what I've heard, given the time scale and where SPT is at the moment, it seems to me that there is time to perhaps introduce a fairly minor piece of primary legislation to change this system while SPT considers, carries on with this consideration of franchising. Would that be correct?
No, I don't think it is. I think we would go back to the 2019 Act. We would have to change that 2019 Act. I don't think that's a short time scale. I keep reiterating it. We either pass the legislation or we don't. And we've already debated what the consequences of that are.
Yes, I understand that. It's a negative instrument. You either pass it or you don't pass it. You accept it or reject it. If it's rejected, there is nothing to stop SPT continuing with their work. And in the meantime...
Yes, they can continue their work.
You would then consider your legislative options. That's correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
And when we consider those legislative options, that is something that I would very much be taking back to the Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, and given that what we've heard already, whatever happens, we're looking at at least 2026 before anything happens. Then there is time to do that.
Yes, there is.
Yes, there is. Okay, I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much. Just seeing if there's any other questions. There doesn't appear to be. So we'll move on to our next agenda item today, which is consideration of motion S6M 15035 to recommend that the Local Services Franchise Traffic Commissioner's Notice and Panel Scotland regulations be annulled. Douglas, can I just clarify if you intend to move this motion?
Yes, I intend to move it.
Thank you. Therefore, just going to remind everyone that Scottish Government officials cannot take part in the formal debate, and I now invite Douglas Lumsden to speak to and move the motion. Other members may contribute after that, then the Minister... and then Douglas to wind up the debate and to press or withdraw his motion. Brief interventions can also obviously be taken at the discretion of whoever is speaking. Douglas, would you like to move and speak to the motion?
Yes, thanks, Kevin, and I move the motion in my name. First of all, Bob Doris asked me about motives on this annulment motion today, and I just want to set it off straight away. This is not to try and derail franchising. This is to make sure that we actually get it right. I actually lodged the motion of annulment. I didn't actually think I would actually be moving it, but actually my idea was to listen to the Minister today, listen to the answers he was given, and then decide. And from the answers that's been given today, it's quite clear that this is not really going to actually delay franchising from what we've given. We heard that in from the last question from Graham Simpson. Of course, Bob.
I appreciate Douglas Lumsden in taking the intervention. Can I get a bit further clarity about your position, Mr. Lumsden, in terms of if we don't implement this provision, would you envisage, Mr. Lumsden, that we should still have a check and balance in the system beyond simply removing the role of the Traffic Commission? In other words, would it be remove this provision but bring in a new provision the Conservatives would think would be appropriate? Or would it be, as others have suggested, we just don't have the check and balance in the system?
No, I think it's, I think what we need to do is make sure that we get legislation that is correct, want legislation that works. And that would be, I think it's up for the government to review what they have in place and then to bring forward changes that will actually do what we want it to do. Because it is clear that, you know, we have evidence that we've seen, we've had experiences in the other parts of the UK that hasn't really worked. Wales are doing something completely different, and I guess I understand that's not comparing apples for apples, but I think it is right that we learn lessons and try and improve the legislation going forward, because I think it would be wrong for us to just to say, well, this is what was decided back in 2019, we need to move forward with this regardless. I think that would be daft, and that's what would end up in a worse situation than we potentially will do. I think I was concerned that if we were to annul this SSI, it would delay things. But I think what we've heard today is that, you know, when we look at SPT, they're going to continue with their work from what we gather. We already seem to be stuck in the slow lane with franchising. So I think this gives us a little bit of time to make sure we get the primary legislation correct and then move forward with a franchising model that will work for us all going forward. And I'll leave it there, Convener.
Thank you very much. Now, I'm looking for members to contribute. I've got Mark first, followed by Bob.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. And yeah, I welcome the fact that, you know, Douglas Lumsden has moved the motion to annul today, because it's enabled us to have a really full debate and discussion and exploration of all the issues, which I felt was lacking at our previous meeting. So it's good that we've now got the opportunity to do that. I believe there is a strong consensus in this committee and within government as well to see bus franchising actually work in this country. But I can't ignore the evidence that's been presented. And I think the need to have a fair decision and a robust decision on franchising is absolutely critical. It seems that the options that we have before us this morning is that, you know, if the annulment effectively goes through, then there'll still be a panel, although it'll be a decision-making panel that will be appointed by the Traffic Commissioner themselves. Or if the SI actually goes through today, then there'll still be a panel. It'll still be a panel that will be appointed by the Traffic Commissioner, but there'll be some additional guidance coming from the Scottish Government. Yep, briefly, yep.
Does he not share my view, though, that in terms of a panel is not going to be created imminently, and actually by the time the Government gets things maybe corrected into a system that we can all agree on, then, you know, we can actually have a panel potentially at that stage or something else. So there is not really going to be a panel that's going to be created by the Transport Commissioner at this time.
Yeah, and I think it's been very useful to have, you know, an understanding of what the timescales would look like for the appointment of the panel. But I suppose my point, Mr. Lumsden, is that regardless of whether we annul or we don't annul, you know, we're still going to have a panel that will be in place. And I'm not actually convinced that the application of guidance to the appointment of that panel will fundamentally change the system that we have, the system that's been put in place through that 2019 Transport Act, which I do believe is fundamentally flawed. So I'd actually think it makes much difference at the end of the day. I don't think we've heard this morning it's not going to make much difference in terms of the timescale that SPT are working towards in terms of working out their proposal. So I feel that in many ways, you know, the government's trying to continually bang a square peg into a round hole here.
I appreciate that perhaps these issues around the complexities and difficulties and the risks around panels weren't foreseen at the time that the Transport Act was going through Parliament. It was some time ago, but this is a point now for government to rapidly reflect on those concerns and to bring forward a system that genuinely offers certainty but is also fair and is also robust. I think, you know, finally, Convener, just reflecting on some of the evidence we've heard, the evidence we've had, you know, from a Welsh Government advisor who said that, you know, in many ways this kind of sets up Scotland as being a backward-facing outlier in terms of its commitment to this panel system. I don't think that's a space that any of us want to be in. I think it's a space that wasn't foreseen in the Transport Act in 2019, but it's the space we're in right now. We have to look at the experience elsewhere within these islands and across Europe. We have to look at what works in terms of getting franchising over the line, in terms of reducing the risk to transport authorities and getting a fair decision. And I'm struggling to see how this is it. With or without guidance around panels, this isn't going to fundamentally change the system that we have. That's very regrettable that we are where we are today. It gives the government clearly a lot of pause for thought at this point. But I'm fearful that we're going to go down a route which is not going to get franchising over the line. And with that, I'm prepared to support Mr. Lumsden's motion to annul.
Thank you, Mark. The next person to speak is Paul.
Convener, I think hindsight is a wonderful thing. I think my issue with the 2019 Act, as we scrutinise this, is I think a negative instrument is probably not the best way to bring forward these regulations. This has kind of got affirmative instrument written all over it, I think, to give a bit more time to it. That said, I do agree we should complete the pathway to franchising as envisaged in a cross-party basis in 2019. Much of the analysis of the potential issues with an independent panel draw on the 2015 experience and the 2017 legislative changes. We passed this Act in 2019. These would have been considered by the Parliament and by this committee. That wasn't on 2019. It would have been considered at that time. Also, that said, I think guidance is key. And the one difference that we have with Mr. Ruscoe, I think we're very close in terms of just wanting a franchising model for the benefit of travellers and commuters in all our communities, getting that partnership approach, is that guidance, I think, is key. I think guidance will make a huge difference. And that's why I would like to know, in the Minister's contribution, a little bit more about how that guidance will be pulled together. Because it's that guidance that Mr. will... Doris. Yes, of course.
Can I thank Bob for giving way? I mean, Would it perhaps not have been better for the government to actually come forward to this committee this morning with a much clearer articulation of what will be in that guidance? I know it's putting the Minister under a lot of pressure to do that and officials, but would it not have been better for us to actually see the guidance? Then we could have made a judgment ourselves as to whether that offers reassurance as to the integrity of the panels or not.
I'm not sure, Mr. Ruscoe. I'm sympathetic to that and I'm tempted to say yes, but I think what I would say is the order and commencement of the regulations and the guidance as it was intended in the 2019 Act. There's nothing untoward in the guidance following the passing of the statutory instrument. That said, there's nothing to prevent the Minister, if this instrument is not annulled, to spend a bit more time with the committee before any guidance would come into force. And I think that's where I would be in relation to this. I think that would be helpful to the committee and to the democratic process. So if this is annulled and does not pass, as we've heard, we'll be left still with a franchising system, but one that appears to be significantly inferior to the system if this instrument was passed. Because the guidance, in one wee second, Mr. Lumsden, but absolutely, the guidance underpins making sure the public interest is at the heart in a prudent, proportionate and appropriate way when this independent panel makes its decision. So I think the guidance is really important to put in place and to pass franchising into existence, which it kind of is already, I suppose. Without this guidance, weakens a franchising system, irrespective of people who've got preferences for what an alternative franchising system may actually look like. Sorry, Mr. Lumsden.
Yeah, no, thanks, Bob, for taking the intervention. You mentioned we'd end up with an inferior process, but surely we'd only end up with an inferior process if the government don't act now to make changes to get this right going forward.
So I appreciate Mr. Lumsden for that intervention, because it gives me the opportunity to say I don't believe this is an inferior process. This is bringing franchising into existence, completing the powers as outlined in the 2019 Act. I think the debate we're having today is about whether there could yet again be another way to do that. And in my questioning of the Minister, I asked that whether or not the Scottish Government would continue to monitor what is happening elsewhere in the UK and beyond. And if they did come to a viewpoint that there could be another way to do it, would they be myopic or would they be open-minded to that? And I think I got a response saying they would be open-minded to that. So on the basis that annulling this is inferior to passing the statute instrument, I would not be supporting the annulment. I think Mr Lumsden as well, is, I identified in yourself to ask Mr Lumsden what your so Mr Lumsden's policy position was in relation to if this didn't pass, would it be to replace a check with a different check and balance in the system? Would it be to remove check and balances? And I think that gets to the heart of what we're talking about, because that wasn't articulated by the member proposing the annulment. I think you were silent in relation to that. I'm happy to have another intervention if you can clarify what your preference would be, Mr Lumsden, but at the moment we just don't know. And as soon as we start changing the goalposts on franchising without knowing what other people are intending, that's worrying for me, because we could come out of a new legislative process with a weaker commitment to franchising, not a stronger commitment to franchising. So I think we have to pass this into law. We have to retain the strongest possible franchising system we possibly can. And then if others want to look at a different system, then we absolutely have got elections in 2026. And I suspect this will be an issue in 2026. And the timescale we're looking at, convener, irrespective of whether the government supports this or not, realistically, and we all know this, convener, is draft legislation, autumn 2026, to review franchising. And given the SPT could be ready to put something to a panel in the winter of 2026, I wouldn't want to take that risk, convener.
Thank you, Bob. The only other person who's indicated they want to speak is Monica, so I'll go to Monica, then I will make a comment, and then we'll come to the Minister. So, Monica.
Okay, thank you, convener. I agree. I think it's important that we're having this debate today, so I do thank Douglas Lumsden for bringing the motion to annul to allow this fuller debate. So, just to be clear, I think, like others who've been speaking today and Get Glasgow Moving and others who've given their views to us as committee members, you know, I want to see a fully integrated, affordable and accessible public transport network to better connect the public. And I think in the face of a climate and nature emergency, cost of living pressures, you know, this has never been more important. So today, before we went into public session, I was feeling a bit conflicted because I don't want to see further delay because we've not made enough progress, but I also don't want to double down on bad practice that we've seen elsewhere. So I think we've had the benefit of time to reflect on the legislation, to look at what's happened elsewhere and to listen really carefully to the experts and campaigners who've taken the time to respond to the committee. And I'm really grateful to all of them for doing that. So it's really, really clear that they're telling us that this model that we're looking at, although not identical, but there are similarities, has been discredited in other parts of the UK. Well, the Minister shakes his head, but in this debate, I think it's important to say that we've had, I think, credible statements to the Parliament Committee saying, don't do this, it would be a mistake. I haven't heard a response from the government today that would make me want to put all that aside. So the point I would want to make is that do we go ahead taking the chance that we're doubling down on bad practice that doesn't serve the people of Scotland well, or do we pause and use the time properly to make sure we've got the best possible system? And that point about delaying, I know a few of us, you know, questioned the Minister on this. I don't think by annulling today that we're risking any timetable, because we've heard that SPT are furthest ahead, but our actions today wouldn't actually get in the way of the work that they have underway. And we do have time as a Parliament to get to work on this. So for those reasons and for the evidence that I've heard today, I will support Douglas Lumsden's motion today. I think it's regrettable that in anticipation of these very legitimate concerns, the Scottish Government hasn't come to the table today and told us very clearly what the Government's view is. And I think it's concerning that we're hearing from Government that they expect bodies like SPT and other regional transport bodies to come to them. I think Government should be much more proactive in reaching out, because these papers are available on the Parliament website as well. I know the Government pays attention, and I think I would have felt more reassured if Government had actually taken the time to reach out to key stakeholders, and I think that is disappointing.
Thank you very much, Monica. Just before I go to the Minister, I'd just like to make a couple of comments. I started off this morning probably being in the same position as Monica, where I wasn't sure that a motion to annul would be the correct way forward. And so I've listened quite well to the comprehensive evidence that we've taken this morning. And I think it's quite interesting, having lived and breathed as convener of the REC Committee, the 2019 Transport Act, and I probably could quote some of the amendments to you, and saw where some of the issues were. This was never flagged up as an issue, and it's not something that we saw. But the committee and the Parliament subsequently supported the franchising system. So I think today has demonstrated to me where this Parliament is at its best, where we're doing something called post-legislative scrutiny. And we're looking at something, and we're saying to ourselves, we're not sure about this. We're not sure if this is the right decision. And indeed, I think that that's where we're at. And I think we've seen that, you know, just because somebody else is doing something, the fact that we should then follow it in Scotland isn't necessarily the right way to go. I am not taken by any of the arguments today that by a motion to annul would delay the franchising system. In fact, I think it will strengthen it. I think it will make it better, because everyone will be bought into it and will be supporting it. Now, I know the Minister, and I don't want to put words into your mouth, said you were acutely aware of the feelings of the committee. And you would consider them afterwards. But it will be up to the Cabinet to decision, as a Cabinet government, to decide whether there can be changes made if this statutory instrument goes through. And there is no guarantee to the committee that changes will be made if we allow it to go through. Things change, politics changes, and therefore we can't be sure of that. So for those reasons alone, and the fact that I have very large concerns that what we're doing might not be the right way to go, I would have to support those members that said that a motion to annul is the right thing to do. And I would just like to put on record, I think it's testament to this committee, that the process of post-legislative scrutiny, which is what we've done effectively on the 2019 Transport Act, has been effective. And on that note, I will pass, Minister, to you before I ask Mr Lumsden to sum up.
OK. It's quite clear where we are in the committee. I'll make one or two observations. Douglas Lumsden said that there will be no delays because we've got the timescale. However, we have no idea whether or not SPT will continue with the process if they now have uncertainty about how this is going to go on. So there is a risk. I'm not saying there will be, but there is definitely a risk of delays for SPT to actually carry on with the process that they're in. So that's the first point that I'll make. Mr Lumsden also said that there will be no panel if we don't pass this. Well, there will be a panel. And as the point has been made on a number of occasions, that panel will be put in place by the Traffic Commissioner without any scrutiny or input from the Government at any point. So it's not quite... Yeah.
Just on to get some clarification. So, Minister, you're suggesting to the committee there's now a risk in terms of what SPT may or may not do, but you've been quite clear to the committee today that you haven't asked SPT their position on this.
No.
So how can you be confident that this increases risk?
I didn't say confident. What I said, it is a possibility. There is huge amounts of time and resource that is going into the process of SPT looking at their financial model and all, everything else that they're going to have to do. So as they go through that process, where we sit right now means that we have stalled the progress of the legislation that would allow them to set up a franchise. So that will now be a decision for SPT to decide whether they want to continue putting the time and resource into that effort when they're not sure what the direction of travel will be if this doesn't pass today. I will, yeah.
So you mentioned SPT. So what discussions have you had, Minister, with SPT?
I haven't had any discussions with SPT. I'm merely making the point that there's a huge amount of time and resource goes into the work that they're having to do around this. And if this is stalled today, I anticipate that there's a risk that they would say, well, until we get the clarity of what this legislation is going to do, we'll pause our spending money and putting resource into this process until we know what that certainty is. So I'm merely making the point that that is a risk. Certainly.
Thank you. Everybody who's spoken, every committee member who's spoken today is in favour of franchising. So, and it's in the Act. So the message to SPT from the Parliament would be that Parliament's in favour of franchising. The only thing that's been debated today is an element of that, which is around the existence of a panel,
yeah,
or not.
Well, so if we carry on with the legislation as it is, there will be a panel, regardless. But and that goes back to the point that Mr. Lumsden made. Sorry, I'll let you finish your point. I apologise, that was rude.
No, that's okay. There doesn't have to be a panel.
There does.
With respect to both of you, I know you're arguing, and it's always great to have an informed discussion. I would like it through me rather than just a sort of head to head, because I struggle to hear both people talking.
I will restrain myself, convener. Sorry, Mr. Simpson.
Quite all right. It's good to see the minister being passionate about the issue. It just seems to me that, you know, if the motion to annul is passed and there is annulled, then the minister has to go away and rethink things. And he has the opportunity to not have a panel if he so chooses. I just make that point to the minister.
Okay, convener, thank you. I disagree with the point that Graeme Simpson has made. If this doesn't pass today and we continue on the process of creating the legislation or finalising legislation to allow franchising to go ahead, that panel will be set up because it is in the primary legislation of 2019. Therefore, the panel will be established by the Traffic Commissioner. The Traffic Commissioner will then do that entirely separate and with any involvement of the Scottish Government or ministers or anybody else. It will be entirely up to the Traffic Commissioner. So it is not true, and that point needs to be clarified before you vote, that if we do not pass this today, there will still be a panel. It just will have no input at all from government or officials. So clearly we have set something going.
Yeah. Can we go first to Bob, and then I think... Minister, it's up to you who you take. But Bob was first, followed by Monica, if that helps you, Minister.
Bob.
So, thank you, Minister. Good, lots of interventions in your contribution. I appreciate that, Minister. I suppose the question I would want to ask is, if the panel is still set up because it's in primary legislation,
yep,
and no one can assume what primary legislation will or will not pass in this Parliament, be it in this parliamentary session or after the 2026 election, would the current Scottish Government still seek, or is it possible to have non-statutory guidance produced by the Scottish Government, which you would ask the Traffic Commissioner and the independent panel to take cognizance of, although they would have no need to do it whatsoever? Because my view, convener, would be, if you can do that, Minister, I would rather have that guidance on a statutory footing rather than a pick and mix, take it and leave it approach from the independent panel.
The assurance that I can give the committee is this, and I can give this assurance, that if we pass this motion today, I will give an absolute assurance that I will come back here to this committee with the guidance as it develops, and the committee can then scrutinise that guidance before it goes into the Traffic Commissioner's remit. But once it becomes the Traffic Commissioner's, it is his or hers, because the whole purpose of this is to take, is to cut the umbilical cord between the political side of things and delivering a project or a process that the people of Scotland want. But I'm more than happy to come back to the committee to talk about the guidance and to try and get that agreed as we go forward. So I can give that commitment. Sorry, there was other interventions. Was it Douglas Lumsden?
Sorry, I think Monica was going to come in next.
Grateful to...
Sorry, clarify this. It's up to the Minister to say who he'll take an intervention from.
I wasn't sure who was first.
Extremely polite behaviour from all committee members, which I would encourage at all times.
Okay, Monica. You go first. My apologies.
Thank you. Everyone's been very nice on the committee today. So I accept, Minister, what you've said about the panel. There will be a panel, but I just want to go back, Minister, because you said that if... the motion to annul is passed, you would be clearing your diary. You and your officials will spend the rest of the day, you know, considering what next. So my question is, if we end up with annulment, you know, could you make a commitment that you would endeavour to not just liaise with the committee, but, you know, bring a statement to Parliament?
Could you repeat that, please, Monica?
Oh, I'm asking that if we have the annulment agreed today, in addition to coming back to the committee, would you also endeavour to make a statement to the whole of Parliament so we can consider, you know, the government's position in terms of next steps? Because we're looking here at getting into the realms of amending the primary legislation, and the government will have options. So
I won't give any commitment as to what I'll do if the amendment is annulled at this point. The only commitment I can give you is that if the amendment is not annulled, or if the legislation is not annulled, I will certainly bring back the guidance to this committee so that we can scrutinise it in this committee. Other than that, I can't give you any other commitment.
Sorry, I noticed members will try and intervene. I did promise before we started this session that I wouldn't look at the clock, but it is inappropriate not to look at the clock occasionally. Members and the Minister can infer from what they wish. Minister, back to you. Up to you to take any interventions you feel are appropriate.
I'll first of all go to Douglas Lumsden and then I'll come back to Mark.
Thanks, Minister. And it's just on the point of panels being created. I'm just trying to think, so the trajectory that SBT are on just now, when would you envisage the panel being created? Whether the SSI was approved or not, would it be 26, 27 or 28?
My officials are in, and convener, I don't know if it's appropriate or not for me to check the dates as a matter of fact, as opposed to asking Bridget to take part in it.
They can slide you a bit of paper with the date on if you want to.
Slide me a bit of paper as to what the timeline is at this moment in time. So we're looking at... Sorry, ask me the question again.
When would you... Looking at SBT's trajectory, when would you anticipate a panel to be created, whether the SSI was approved or not?
The panel to be created?
Yes.
26, 27. Somewhere in 26, 27.
Thank you.
Sorry, somebody else... Yeah, Mark.
Yeah, I appreciate the Minister giving way. It's been a very challenging session.
It's been fine. There's been no problems.
You're rolling with it. That's great. One clarification. I think your official mentioned in the previous consideration there's still, I think, one more piece of legislation that's required to bring in the provisions for franchising. So I'd like to just hear commitment that work is still going to continue. and it's very welcome what you're saying, Minister, in relation to the fact that even if you don't need to supply the guidance, if the annulment goes through, you will still work on the guidance and that will still be available for the Traffic Commissioner. But can I also ask you, some of the concerns that are being raised here come down to the independence of the Traffic Commissioner and the appointment of the Traffic Commissioner. And the Minister will remember that the previous Commissioner did an interview which appeared to be quite prejudicial towards franchising. And that has really riled people who want to see franchising happen because it is within the public interest. So can I ask you, what kind of assurances can there be that the incoming Traffic Commissioner
clearly understands their responsibilities, but also clearly understands the policy priorities of government and this parliament to see franchising work successfully in Scotland, as I think is the case in Wales, where there's that strong public commitment.
I will defer to the convener.
As you briefly answer that question, I would encourage you to come to the very winding up bit of your thing.
Okay. So, in terms of, and I'm going to clarify one point. I said that I will absolutely come back to this committee with the guidance as we develop it, if this motion to annul was not passed. So let's be absolutely clear on that. So that's the point that I made. And the second point you've asked about I'm trying to think of my words carefully here. The integrity of the Commissioner's ability to make that decision independently. Well, that kind of goes to the heart of whether or not we trust people that we give jobs to. And bearing in mind, it will not be the Scottish Government who appoint a Traffic Commissioner. It will be the Secretary of State for Scotland. Now, we may have someone sitting on the panel who will be part of that process. But that process of them deciphering who the Traffic Commissioner is going to be will be up to them. We then have to accept the fact that that was the decision that was made, and therefore that is the Traffic Commissioner that we will work with. I'm going to make one final point. Monica Lennon talked about the fact that there were slight differences. They weren't identical at all. The models were not identical. The system that did not pass then in England was looking only at the financial model, and the model that we're looking at is a much bigger group, is a much bigger model. So I will wind up by saying this, convener. I would very much like the committee to rethink some of the things that we've said at the end there, that you're minded to annul this, which will give us the certainty to continue on the work that we've already been doing for the last number of years. And well, we've had the debate, so I'll leave it at that.
Minister, and I'm going to ask Douglas Lumsden to briefly wind up.
I will briefly wind up. Like others, I didn't come here today convinced that the annulment motion was the right way forward, but after listening to the Minister's answers on some of the ways that maybe there seemed to be no real commitment there that the process might change going forward. So I think it's really the only option we have, because I think continuing using this model with the evidence that we've had, you know, I don't think we'd be doing our scrutiny function any justice. And, you know, I think we've heard the times. I will give way.
Yeah, so what is it in the process that the member wants to change? Because we either have a panel or we don't. And if we don't have a panel by going back to primary legislation. So does the member want us to go back to primary legislation and go through the primary legislation process in order to remove the panel, which will absolutely go into 26, 27 or beyond, depending on what the political structures look like? And what certainty does that give to any organisation who are looking to establish a franchising system right now? Because I have to say, if I was the chief executive of an organisation and not having a clue what the next government, whatever that shape or form that takes, would do on franchising, I'd be stopping everything.
Well, Minister, I think what we've heard is around the room that there's not any voices against franchising, but we just want to make sure it's done in the correct way. And you may pull a face on that if you want, but we've seen so much time having bad
intervention.
I will take that intervention.
Right. Sitting around this room is one thing. What the wider discussion, we have got to the point now, we are on the cusp of being able to give local authorities, or transport authorities, all the powers that they need to do the thing that we want to happen. There's no guarantee that that's going to continue in the next session. There's no guarantee that that legislative process is going to occur. We are where we are, and I understand the concerns that the committee have around the panel. I've given commitments on how we can give the surety that the guidance that will be in that panel's remit is robust and fair. But if we stop it, then we put a huge delay, a possible huge delay, on the processes that SPT or anyone else would want to continue with, because they do not have the certainty.
Can I just clarify? Interventions are to ask questions, and I everyone's had a chance to make statements. So I'm going to try and push this one more time. Mr. Lumsden, would you briefly to wind up?
Yeah. My question was, what would be the alternative?
It's up to Mr. Lumsden whether he takes a question or whether he continues to wind up.
Yeah, I will continue to wind up. But of course, what we've seen is primary legislation can come very quickly to this Parliament. We're seeing that in the next agenda item that we've got today. So if there's will from the government to actually move forward with this franchising, to have it in place before the next election, they can do so if there is political will. And I encourage the Minister to talk to the Cabinet Secretary and make sure that the political will is there and get primary legislation back before us as quickly as possible so we can move forward with franchising. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And I know that Mr. Dorris and Monica and Jackie, with respect, I think we've come to the end of the bit, and this is the bit where I get to ask a question rather than anyone make comments. So my question is the motion S6M15035 in the name of Douglas Lumsden be agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed, so it will go to a vote. Those in favour of it, please raise their hands. Those against it, please raise their hands. Okay, so the results of the vote, there are four members in favour, three members against, there are no abstentions, therefore the motion is agreed. Now, given that the committee must produce a report on this draft instrument, the deadline for producing it is extremely tight, and it will have to be very short and factual. Is the committee content to delegate to me the responsibility to clear the clerk's draft for publication later today? That's the timescale. Yeah, okay, thank you. Thank you, Minister, and your officials for attending. I'm now going to suspend for 10 minutes to allow a changeover of witnesses and before we move to the next session. So we'll meet here at 10:42.